Kutchin, and I'll be teaching in Fundamentals of Music this semester. You should have your book. So they won't have this cover because my cover fell off a long time ago. This is old. One of the first ones. I think it still looks the same. But anyway, should be a photo someplace here of the one you need to get. Maybe Fundamentals of Music, not to be confused with Beginning Oral Skills or any of the other ones that have notes. Oral Skills 1 has one note on it, and Oral Skills 2 has two notes on it. But you don't want those. You want this for oral skills, you know, with all the ear and stuff, beginning, okay. And then Fundamentals, here's the back page. There's Dr. Wallace. Not used to this backwards thing. Okay, all right, so you need the book, because you're going to be doing some assignments, and then you're going to be taking a photo of it and sending it to me. And so be sure you have your book, all right? At the beginning here, we're gonna be doing a lot of learning notes. That's the first thing you have to do. You have to do it very quickly too. As you know your notes, treble and bass clef, you have to know them fast. You have to be able to recognize them like that. It's like reading. You're gonna be learning a foreign language. It's foreign to you right now, even though you might have listened to it, music. You're going to be learning the parts of it, just like how we use, you'll learn your letters, which make words, which then you make sentences and paragraphs. Well, it's the same with music. You have to learn the letters first, because you don't know the letters, you can't make words. And you can't put together the music if you don't know the parts of it. So it's super important, because if you're taking this class, that means you're behind. All right. And so we want to get you caught up. I got these glasses that they're purple. It's weird. I wish I could take them back, but I've had them too long. Oh, no, no, they're, if I feel like this, there's no purple. Like, oh, anyway. So you need to know your notes. All right. And so we're going to go over that in a little bit. All right. Now, in music, a long time ago, they started coming up with ways of making symbols to represent sounds, particular sounds, pitches. And you can study it. It's pretty cool. I've enjoyed studying the way music has developed over the centuries. People came up with this idea, which led to this idea and that kind of thing. But we eventually ended up with a system where we use five lines and four spaces. All right. And this is our graph that we use to put symbols on that represent notes and rhythms, all right, pitches and rhythms. Pitch. There's a difference between a pitch and a note. And you'll hear those terms interchangeably. But a pitch is the highness and lowness of a note. That's what a pitch is. So you could say an A note, but is that low note or is that a high note? But if I said the pitch is the A above middle C, then it's a specific pitch. It has a specific frequency that produces that sound. So you'll hear the term pitch and note often, sometimes talking about the same thing. But just know that we're talking about a pitch. We're talking about that's the same note. It's the same note name. I don't know what it is. But those are two different pitches. I have my headphones plugged in. Plug the headphones out, unplug. All right, that's an E. That's an E note. That's an E note, but they're two different pitches. Does that make sense? That's a low E, and there's a higher E. And there's an even more high E. That's a different pitch. It's still an E. All right, those are all the E note, but they're different pitches. All right, so that's the difference between notes and pitches. All right, so I might say an E, and you go, okay, I know that E and that E and that E and that E. Those are all E's. bass clef, and treble clef. But they're all different pitches. These are high and those are low. All right, so I think you got that. So I'm gonna move past that. Now, where'd you go? I just bumped something. Oh, there it is. In music right now, in Western music, there are 88 notes. Well, it's probably more than that when you could factor in A flat, G sharp, you know, but anyway, sounds, pitches. There are 88 pitches on the piano. All right, 88. Now, if you were if you had all the notes written out on a piece of paper, on a graph, you'd have a huge 88 lines of spaces. You'd have to put 88 lines of spaces, or maybe 44. I haven't thought about it all the way through, but you'd have a lot of lines. Let's just say this. If you had a note, you had to put a note on the paper for every pitch there is on the piano, you'd have a lot of lines of spaces. You'd be like, where's the C sharp? Oh, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's 44th. I found it. You know, it's like, it'd be impossible, right? Well, you know, at one time back in the day when they started doing this, they had different lines of space. They had like 12 or 8. You know, they had finally we settled down on 5 lines, 4 spaces. But where are those? If we didn't have those things right there, it just means nothing, right? 5 lines, 4 spaces could be anything. How are we going to figure out where the notes are on whatever, the instrument, your voice, whatever we're looking at? Where are those pitches on just 5? We need more lines and spaces. Ding! Somebody had a smart idea. Put a symbol here to say, now I know exactly on the piano or on my guitar or on my trombone or whatever, exactly what pitch that is because of this. Now, these are called clef signs. All right. Now, a clef sign is a marker on sheet music, manuscript paper, we call it, that now I know exactly where on the piano or pitch-wise, where that particular note lands, where it sounds, right? This tells me, this is called the treble clef. You probably know this, treble clef. Treble clef sign. But it's also called the G clef. The G clef sign. Now, that's a terrible treble clef. Where's my eraser? That's much better. All right. Now, this little curly Q here tells me that this line right here is G4. It's the fourth octave G on the piano. So if you go to the very bottom left-hand side of a standard piano or keyboard, has 88 keys, that note right here, which that little curly Q goes around, is going to be the fourth G up from the left-hand side. It's going to 1, 2, 3, 4. It's right in the middle of the piano. So because of this little treble clef or G clef, it curls around this note, which tells me this is the G. Well, now that I know that, where that is in the piano, then I know where all the rest of them are. Oh, that's a G. Oh, so that's an A, and that's a B, that's a C, D, E, F. So these clef signs are very important. The other clef sign that we use a lot, especially if you're in choral music, you play guitar, you play piano, most instruments, there are some other clef signs that tell us, have a different set of information, which you'll learn that later, not in this class. Well, I guess we will learn some in this class. Anyway, doesn't matter. Bass and treble clef, or the G clef and the F clef. This is called the F clef. All right. So this is the F, just like Frank, like fiddle, fibel, vubler, fibel, 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 Frank, Fuddruckers, the clef, F clef, or bass clef. Most people call it a bass clef, but specifically, this is an F clef. Now, you probably have guessed that this tells me where The F, a particular F though, it's F, we call it F3, it's the third octave F. So if you start from the very bottom of the piano on the left-hand side, and you count up the Fs, one, two, boom, you'll come to this F right here. Now you'll notice I have two little dots following this little hook-looking thing. And these two little dots are above and below this line right here. That line is, that note right there on that line is an F. And it is specifically the F below middle C, or F3, third octave F. So now that I know that's an F, then I know that's an E, and that's a D, and that's a C, and that's a B, and that's an A, that's an F, so that's a G, A, B, C, all right? So clef signs are very important. They tell us exactly where this pitch sounds. I know exactly, I can look and I go, oh, I know right where that is on the piano. Right. It's very important because we only have 5 lines and 4 spaces to work with. We don't have 88. So they had to find, this is the best way they came up with, and it works well, to say, okay, because of this, I know that on the piano, the notes that are going to fit on those 5 long spaces are about that. I mean, it can cover quite a bit of the piano. You know, I can, all the way from E up to E. So there's an octave right there. I mean, it goes, you can do more than that, of course. But down here, I know that that's an A, F, G, A, and also that's an A. There's an, we call that an octave, 8 notes apart, right, which we'll learn about that later. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about trying to remember everything. Like, oh, I got to remember now. We're going to go over it a bunch of times, okay? Plus, it's in your homework, and you're going to learn it, okay? All right, so clef signs are very important. They tell us, oh, this graph is telling me specifically on the piano. I mean, I'm using the piano because that's the easiest thing to look at and see. It's the best object lesson thing, whatever, you know, but I don't know what I'm trying to say, but something you look at. and it's like, oh, okay, so I know, I can look at this music and I know right where they are. Oh, that's bass clef, okay, that's over here on the piano, all right? So go like that. All right. So something we're going to work on, and you're going to remember, are the clef signs and what that means. What's a G clef? What's an F clef? And why is it called a G clef? Oh, why is it called an F clef? Oh, because the F clef tells me, those little dots on top and below that particular line tells me, oh, that's an F. Oh, interestingly enough, if you go back and research this. Back in the olden days, this was actually a very fancy F, a very ornate looking F. And over time, it ended up looking like this, which I don't know. I tried to do some research on it, but I never could really, not something to my satisfaction. It's just same thing here. This used to be a really fancy G, and it eventually became this, which looks like an S to me. But anyway, so, and now we can forget about that. All right. All right, so what I'd like you to do, your first assignment, and I'm going to want you to email these to me. So it's very important in this class that the assignments I give you on our DBU, you know, email your email, my email, we're all going to have emails, the DBU emails, that you'll do the assignment, and I want you to take a picture of it, or you can scan it somehow, whatever. But I want you to email me your assignment. All right. When you do it, it says it will now give you instructions on when it's due. But your first assignment is I want you to take a piece of manuscript paper. Now, you can go buy manuscript paper. I think I'm going to give these instructions someplace on Blackboard. But I would suggest if you have a printer, don't buy it. You can print them off free. And I should have some websites to go to a place and you can, you know, download it. But whatever you do, don't get more than five lines per page. I mean, eight lines per page. Don't get 10 or 12. It's just, especially not 12. I mean, you can kind of get away with 10. Here's the reason is you need space between these staves. These are called a staff, and a bunch of them are called staves, S-T-A-V-E-S, all right? So if you get too tight, like this, one thing I don't like about this whiteboard I got is that they're too close. So, because you got to write stuff in between them. I mean, if you're writing songs, you have to have write lyrics between them. And these, when they get too tight, you're not able to write stuff. It gets really messy. So when you get your manuscript paper and you print it off, I would suggest you just go with 8 staves per page. Not, you could get away with 10, but a lot of times they sell them like 12. They're just like crammed together. And people buy them all the time. And it's kind of like, you know what? You're going to have trouble. So get something that's only 8 staves per page. All right. So once you get that, then I want you to practice drawing the bass, the G clef and the F clef. All right. And I want you to do it. Each one, I want you to write them 15 times. And I want it to be beautiful. Okay. Now think about writing music and music theory and writing songs and all that stuff. You want to be as neat as possible. And I know for some of you, that's like, oh my goodness, I was supposed to be a doctor. I can't read. And trust me, I am a slob in every area of my life except for music. Well, I've gotten better over the years because my precious wife is so good at, she's so organized and neat and takes care of things and keeps, and I've learned from her. But in music, you really need to be precise because in music business, time is money. And if they're having to pause and go, I can't understand this. No, you don't want that. Yeah. I have actually gotten jobs because of my manuscript, because my notes and my lyrics and all that stuff was neat. In fact, I actually made money taking people's songs and they didn't know how to write music and they would pay me to write their music out, you know. And we have software now to do that, but it's amazing how many times you have to write music by hand because you're not in a situation where you can print it off or you can, you know, you can do it. And maybe we'll be one day, but there'll always be a need to be able to write by hand music. So we want it to be as neat as possible. This is a work of art. You want it to look like a work of art. You want it to be gorgeous. So you're like, I have no artistic bone in my body. I can't draw to save my life. Me either. But you can learn. I mean, I was always so jealous of those guys, you know, in school. People could do artwork and they'd do motorcycles and women and stuff. And I'm just like, everybody else like look like an alien, you know. I didn't even try. Eventually, I was kind of like, I'm no artist. But I've learned, you know. And you can learn too. So I want everything to be neat and tidy. So I want 15 treble clef signs, and I want 15 bass clef signs, and I'm looking for perfection. So here's what you have to do: you take your book or get a piece of music or look on the web and just look up treble clef signs and bass clef signs, and then I want you to copy them perfectly. I want you to get used to like, okay, I start here and goes up here and then here and boop boop, and I want it to look pretty. I want it to look way better than mine. Way better. I want to be able to hire you to write my music for me because I'm not as good as you. That's how we want it, all right? So that's your first assignment. Then I want you to take a picture of what you've done or scan it and then send it to me in an email, all right? And you want to look for instructions how to do that, all right? Let's see. Let's move on to notes. The notes on these things. All right. Now, like I said earlier, music is a language, and the language has an alphabet. And we're gonna learn where the, now in the alphabet in music, you don't just write on a piece of paper. It actually has a place, a graph you can put it on, so that we can interpret it, all right? And each one of these little pitches have a note name attached to them, okay? So once we talked about the G clef here, so we know that's a G, all right? So let's look at the G clef, where these note names belong, all right? So that's a G. So once again, if that's a G, then as I go down the staff, the pitches go lower. So So da 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 da. All right. So G. So the note below G, which would be a space note on this graph, this staff, is going to be an F. If I go down one more note, which would be a line note, okay? So notes go up and down by space, line, that's how they move, okay? So this would be an E, that would be a D, right? Now I'm gonna start from here and I go here, now that's an A, that's a B, that's a C, now it's a, I got excited. I'll wait and get excited in a minute. All right. And then here's D. Now see that D note is 8 pitches down from that D note. So they're both a D. So they sound the same, except one's high and one's low. All right. So this D and this D. So let's play the piano. This D is right. I gotta get my keyboard so I can get to it more. Is up, all right? And this D, that one, it's a little out of my range. I used to have no problem with that note back when I was young. Okay, so if I keep going, that's an E, and so forth, F. Now we can keep going above and below these the staves. We use these things called ledger lines, which are like temporary lines. Just like these lines are permanent, we have little temporary lines that we use to show, oh, that's note, it's there, but we don't have a line to put it on, so we're just going to make a line. And you'll see a lot of those. We use those a lot. All right. All right. Bass clef. Boop, boop. All right. So we know the bass clef, that's an F. Now this F is 8 notes lower than that note right there. It's the same note name, but it's 8 pitches lower. That's an F. So if that's an F, then I come down one note down, it's going to be on the space note, and that's going to be an E. One note down from that is going to be on the line note, and that's a D. One note down from that is a C. One note down from that is B. Notice I'm going backwards down the alphabet, right? So that's a B. That's a terrible B. There's an A. And so that's a G. That's as far as I'll go right now. All right. Now, if I go up, well, that note, that's an F. So what's that note? That's a G, which is 8 notes lower than that note. 8 pitches lower, excuse me, not notes. Well, it is 8 notes too. 8 G to G, so that's an octave. But that's higher than this one, okay? So then I have this on top of the line here, that's an A, and then that would be a B, and that would be a C, okay. Notice this A, and that A, and that A, they're all A's. But they're different in pitch, higher and lower from one another. Mm-hmm. All right, so that's how the notes flow on this graph, this staff. Right? As the notes go higher in pitch, they go up the alphabet. And as they go down lower, they go backwards down the alphabet. And that's how notes work on staves, a staff. Okay. All right, so your job, you choose to accept it, you want to choose to accept it, right? All I want you to do is do the clef signs for me, nice and pretty, gorgeous, beautiful, works of art, something I can frame on my wall above my piano. When people walk in the room, they go, what is that? So my students' artwork, they're called clefs. I show them off. I'll put them on Facebook. Look what my students did. Look at this one. This made me cry. It was so beautiful. All right. So then I want you to do this page 91. I want you to do page 91. And once again, once you take a picture of it on your camera, or you can scan it. I don't know other ways to do it. If there's another way that you can email it to me, that I could tell what it is. But right now, I guess you could draw it. You could have your friend of yours do an art painting of it. Well, that would be awesome, actually. All right. So you're going to just follow directions here. Number the spaces on the staff below. Number the lines. Practice drawing well-written. Hey, another practice set here you can do. I want you to do it. Draw at least 5. So by the time you get done with this whole thing, you'll be an expert at drawing cleft signs. And I want you to be. Like I say, neatness counts. I'm looking for neatness. We all are. And music theory is super important. That you're neat, tidy, all that kind of stuff. Write the musical alphabet ascending, starting from each given letter and stopping when you reach the beginning letter again. So you're going to go up an octave or down an octave. All right. There's descending from those pitches. Provide the names on the treble clef line. I want you to write the note names in. This is all designed to help you get faster at identifying pitches. There's bass clef. Write those in. Name each note below. Be careful to watch the clef. Try to complete this without looking at a reference model as fast as you can. You want to get away from having to look it up, because you're not going to be able to look it up. You're playing music. You don't have to like, oh, hang on a second, I got to look at my book. You just know it. Mm-hmm. All right. So that assignment will be due. Turn that homework in for me, please. And I don't know how long I've gone, but I think I've gone almost 30 minutes. So we will continue on into the next session. All right. If you have any questions, email me, text me, call me, send a carrier pigeon or your little brother on a bike or whatever it takes. But don't be confused about something. Clarify it. Ask questions. You're in college now, so it's your job. And you can't show up going, I don't know what to do. No. That'll make me angry. Or you know, you don't turn any assignment in or whatever, because no. Clarify, ask questions, super important. All right. In our home, it's called, we have a phrase, one of our phrases that we've had for 30 years or more is, initiative makes you a hero. My wife came up with that with our sons. Initiative makes you a hero. And wow, my boys are cool. They get things done. It's pretty awesome. So it's your job to educate, right? I'm just here to help, but also be grading you. So, all right, like I say, talk to me if you have any questions or confusion, and I'll see you next time.